that's really good singing. I enjoy the kids. I enjoy the special. I enjoy the congregational. I enjoy, more than anything, I enjoy our Savior. That's what it's all about. I pray that your heart is again drawn to the Lord. Our kids are prepared and ready. We pray that you'll be back tonight. Invite someone to come with you. It'll be a good evening to worship the Lord through our kids program. And in the end, it's Christmas time. It's really easy again for us to become prepared and ready and enjoy the season. And we're glad that you're here this morning. I want you to do something. I want you to look around yourself right there. See who's around you. Do that for like 5 seconds. Look around, see who's around you. And look and basically do this. Look who's around you and then notice who's not. Okay, notice who's not around you and who's missing for whatever the reason. Maybe they're out of town. It's Christmas time. Some are sick. Many of you are battling sickness and different things. And some folks just may not be here. And if that's the case, we want to take note of that. And let them know we love them. Let them know we miss them when they're not here. And by the way, we miss them when they're not here, right? That's about half of us. Glory to God for that. Appreciate that. We do miss you when you're not here, and we want to love on people. And so let them know. Call them, email them, Twitter them, or whatever. I don't know, whatever you want to do to them. Let them know, and let them know we miss them and we love them, and pray the Lord will bless them. By the way, did you notice Dr. Clayton is here today? Want to be sure to point him out. Miss Mary Ellen is not here today. She, of course, is still recovering and been a bit of a slow go. Last week and a half have been a little difficult for her. And so be sure to keep them in your prayers. It's good to see Dr. Clayton with us today, and glad that he's able to attend. Well, by the way, I'm going to do one more thing before I get started. I want to point out Kelly Humphrey. I haven't had a chance to point out little Kelly. Little Kelly is already now 5 or 6 weeks old or so. They've been in services for the last 2 or 3 weeks, I think, with little Kelly. But I haven't had a chance to focus on her. Now, the last I saw, she was in a carrier. Is that right? Is she right there with you? Can you hold the carrier for us, Brother David? Let us gawk at the carrier at least. You going to drag her out of it? Kelly, I'm sorry if you're sleeping. There you are. Look at that. Good morning. I haven't had a chance, or I haven't focused on them, and we're glad that baby is safe. Mom and family are doing well, and again, we're glad that they're able to be with us in services this morning. Well, Matthew chapter 7. Let's go right there. Let's take our attention to the 7th chapter of Matthew. We're still in the Sermon on the Mount and want to consider, again, the mountain peaks of Christianity. We're, a week and a half away from the celebration of Christmas and our Savior's birth. Again, it's really easy for us to become excited and to enjoy the thought of Christmas. And I trust that your heart is in tune with the Lord. I do want to say this as well. I look around the church in the last couple of 3 months, and I mentioned to you before, I think our church is going through a really difficult time in a lot of different ways. Many of you families are what I would call, Pastor Scott and I talked about it again this week, I would simply call it this: I believe our church is under attack. That's how I feel. Many of you are dealing with things you've never dealt with. Many of you, whether it's health or spiritual or relationship, financial, marital, family, it doesn't make any difference. There are so many things going on that I do believe it's causing us to really check our heart and stay in tune with the Lord. By the way, if your life is at peace and everything is good and you have no clue what I'm talking about, praise the Lord. If you are going through things and you have a concept of what I'm talking about, then hold your ground. Hold your ground. Stay focused on the Lord. Fight the good fight, Paul told Timothy. And at a time like Christmas, it ought to be, again, a little easier in a sense to hone in on the Lord. Again, there are so many fires, if you will, around our church with different situations. And so churches go through those seasons, and I think we're in one. And so stay focused on the Lord and chin up, and may the Lord remind you daily of His grace and mercy, and may we always ever love the Lord. Amen. Amen. You agree with that? Amen. Sermon on the Mount is good for us because at times like this, we're reminded as we battle, as we go through different things, we're reminded of some of the very core beliefs of our Christian journey. We're reminded and we're taught by the Lord on the Sermon on the Mount these things that are so critical to our just our behavior, our thought processes, and again, our Christian walk before the Lord. These teachings we've come through the first couple of chapters in chapter 5 and 6 are just the core, basic, fundamental, doctrinal beliefs that kind of give the structure to our life, to allow our lives to stay on track and stand strong for the Lord. And we just admonish one another in the truths that God has given to us. Amen. By the way, these truths, and I won't recount every one of them, but when you start talking about things like loving your enemy, I mean, that's almost impossible. It is impossible outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's impossible for us to do. To give marriage and the issues of the sanctity of life and of marriage, they're due, and to understand the damage of adultery and the damage of divorce and remarriage and all those things, it's important that we build a structured life around those truths. Amen. And even though our society is just being shredded by the issues of marriage and divorce and all those things, in the end, as Christians, no matter where you've come from, no matter where your background, in the end, now and here, God wants us to lay hold of the truths and build them into our life and uphold the things that God has taught us and the things that we are convinced about. Amen. Amen. Where our society wants to throw the things of God aside, it's important for us, even in the midst of our own battle, to stand up and lay hold of the doctrines of Christ. Amen. And for that, God certainly blesses us. And here we find another one this morning that is kind of a hot-button issue in our society. And matter of fact, I firmly believe it's one of the major eroding factors to society, to family, to church, to our nation. And it's that idea of judgment we find in the 7th chapter. Matthew chapter 7, those first 5 or 6 verses give us the teaching on the idea of judgment. Now, verse 1 is probably the one in which many people have quoted, many people kind of camp out on, and they seem to go no further. And it's important that we as Christians understand the biblical teaching on judgment. Now, verse 1 is the one, again, most of us probably know. Judge not, lest ye be judged. How many of you have heard someone use this verse just in general conversation? How many? All right. That's at least 80% of the crowd. I've heard people say it as well. You know, don't judge me. You know, judge not, lest ye be judged. Of course, we typically hear that in the context of, you know, you can't judge me. Number one, you don't have the right. You don't have the authority. And in the end, I don't like you telling me right or wrong. Is that right or not? I just don't like you telling me any kind of parameters about life. And so when it comes to judgment, let's be honest, we're all a little sensitive. We're all a little sensitive. I remember growing up, and I was just thinking about different judges in my life. Not Samsons and Gideons, I don't mean that. The judges in my life started off probably when I was old enough to realize what I called mom and dad. They were the judges of my life. By the way, there were days I did not like my judges. Anybody feel the same way as me? Good. Matter of fact, if you don't say yes, you're lying. Amen. You're lying. I found other judges in my life. I loved to play ball, and so when I got in fourth grade, I began to play baseball on the little team there in my little town. And the first time I went up to the plate with the bat in my hand that I was going to bat, and I watched that ball. I was taught as a little boy, you know, you have to watch the ball. And by the way, baseball has so many lingo terms that's a whole language in and of itself. Watch the ball hit the bat. Well, who really can do that? Watch the ball. And so I began to watch the ball. And the first time I watched the ball hit my body, that was not a good day. And I remember judging my coach. What do you mean to stand there and take that? That's what I'm supposed to do. Who does that? Well, they said, watch the ball come over the plate. And when it's in the right spot, you swing the bat, hit the ball. Well, I remember standing there watching the ball come my way, and I didn't hit it. I let it go by because I didn't think it was a good pitch to hit. And the umpire said, strike. And I said, Dad, you're a terrible judge. You know, you need glasses. That was not a strike. I remember a couple years later playing basketball. Loved basketball. I began to play, and our coach taught us to be aggressive. We used to do what they call the press. And so anytime the other team has the ball, we were right there on the full length of the court pressing on them and trying to steal the ball away. And I remember the first time I heard the whistle blow, and the referee pointed his hand at me and raised his hand. Foul, number 31, holding. And I was like, what are you talking about? I didn't even touch the guy. You with me? You need glasses too. I didn't touch him. He fouled me, matter of fact. Even though he had the ball, he fouled me. I didn't like my judge. I played football for years. Same situation. The first time the little yellow hanky came flying out of the pocket, and the referee began to make the call. Holding, number 53, blue. That's me. I didn't even touch the guy. You know? Where's the replay? You know, I didn't like my judges. I mean, the first time I got a job, and my boss came to me and said, "Now, Andy, here's the way you're supposed to do the job." And I said, "Okay, I can do that." A few minutes later, he came back and said, "That's not the way you do the job." "Yeah, but I thought this was a little bit better." He's like, "It ain't better. Matter of fact, what you need to do now is just stop thinking and do what I tell you to do." And at 18, I'm thinking, who are you to tell me? I know how to do this better. I can run this whole place better than you. You need glasses too. Come on, am I speaking truth or not? We don't like judges. We don't like anything that has the appearance of setting parameters or boundaries or telling us right or wrong or correcting us. And the concept of judgment in our society, I would simply say this, it's not a very biblical view. Agree? Now, the word here in verse 1 of chapter 7, the word judge here, judge not lest you be judged, the word really does mean condemnation. Don't condemn one another. And I remember, again, growing up and growing in my Christian walk, and I began reading the scriptures, and I remember learning the idea that you know, one of the good issues of your Christian journey is to be a good employee. Your boss is your boss, so when you go there, represent the Lord well. Do a good job for your company, whether you like the company or not, but you represent the Lord and do your job well, and do it as if you were serving the Lord. Amen. That's the right thing. And I remember learning, though, that this idea of judgment was, you know, ultimately, I have absolutely zero ability in condemning, really, anyone. Because if you're going to condemn, and really you ought to have the ability or the power to pass judgment or to pass the consequence as well. Guess what? That belongs to the Lord. That belongs to the Lord. Judge not lest you be judged. Verse 2 goes on to another truth there and simply says, the same judgment of which you judge, you will also have measured unto you again. That's a paraphrase of verse 2 there. And he simply talks about that the cautionary teaching is that if you're going to pass condemnation, be careful, because you too are under the watchful eyes of condemnation. You too are under the watchful and the consequences of judgment yourself. Judge not that ye be not judged, for with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. But when it comes to our idea, not only of accepting the concept of judgment, but then learning as a Christian the true biblical concept of judgment and discernment in our life, it's a critical foundational truth that we must have in place. And I say that because of this. Listen, children are not naturally born with the ability to judge well. Is that right? The lost person has not an ability to discern or judge well. The concept of truth, right and wrong, black and white, is often obscured in the minds of lost people. And so our world needs Christians to help identify and give color, if you will, to the concept of right and wrong. Amen. Our world needs the ability, our nation needs the ability, and have someone to stand up and say, this is what God says, this is the judgment of God, and this is the discernment of God in the issues of life. And someone, that someone being us, needs to stand up and stand strong for the Lord Jesus Christ. You agree? Well, the concept here is that we would not pass judgment. The concept is, though, that we would have certainly an understanding of what judgment is about. Let's continue reading verse number 3. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye? The word mote is understood as a speck of dust or a piece of sawdust that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam or the rafter that is in thine own eye. Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you. Verse 6 is really a transitionary verse in the context, because he begins to hint at the idea that listen, if we're going to take the very truths of God and have no discernment about how to share those things, we might as well throw our pearls to the swine. There needs to be some discernment, even in our evangelization. Now, the truth here about judgment, this particular mountain peak of truth and judgment, it must be understood, and it must be understood how then to apply it to our life and to exercise it not only in our life but apply it to those around us, whether we're parents or friends or workers or bosses or evangelists. In either case, we must understand how to apply judgment correctly. James Montgomery Boyce, in his book on the Sermon on the Mount, he says, if the devil is not able to destroy a Christian's witness by making him apathetic, then he will try to do it by making him a fanatic. And he makes this point in his book because, as we just finished up the 6th chapter, he suggests and points out that there's really a couple of things that will make Christians apathetic to things in life, and certainly to the gospel witness, and that is the idea. Number one, the pursuit of money and materialism over the pursuit of the righteousness of God. You find a Christian who is more concerned about worldly things than godly things. You find a person who has lost their passion for the causes of Christ. Amen. And that apathy can settle in to the heart of a believer. He also suggests and points out that the idea of worry. Verse 25 in chapter 6 says, be anxious for nothing. The word anxious is the idea of worry. Being worried about life, whether again money, family, job, doesn't matter, health issues, in the end, we take and steal faith away from trust in God, and we worry about it to the point we can't function and we lose hope. And in the end, we become apathetic. Find a believer and point one out who has lost, in a sense, their trust and faith in God's daily provision and in God's daily direction. You'll find a believer who will slowly lose their hope in Christ and slowly lose the passion that they have for the things of God. Amen. Now, he counters that with chapter 7, the first 5 or 6 verses. On the other extreme, however, of apathy is that idea of a fanatic. What he calls a fanatic, I would simply call it this. It's a critical spirit of those Christians who think they're more righteous by simply pointing out the defects in other people's lives. Judge not, lest thou be judged. By the way, have you seen both extremes? By the way, is your motor moving? All right, a little sluggish. Found those people that are apathetic. I'm going to tell you, one of the hardest Christians to visit with and talk with and preach to are apathetic Christians. It's like trying to resurrect a corpse, because they've seemingly lost their passion for God, their interest in God, their interest in the things of God, and their desire to do anything with the things of God. And to preach to them almost becomes hurtful and damaging rather than encouraging. And sometimes the apathetic Christian needs to be like Adam from Genesis chapter 2. He only needs God's breath of life breathed into him in some miraculous way. Maybe you've met somebody like that. We often call those churches dead. Dead churches. Seems to be nothing happening in those places. There seems to be no movement of God or no movement of the Spirit of God. And listen to me, God doesn't want us to be apathetic. Matter of fact, it's somewhat of a characteristic of the last church of Revelation, that Laodicean church, where because of their riches, they've become apathetic to the things of God. They don't even need God in their life. And oh, by the way, we're living in such times. The other side of that's that critical spirit. You ever met somebody who's the critical Christian? Your clothing ain't right. Your hair ain't right. Your language ain't right. You with me? Your behavior's not right. And everything about your life, there's always a pointing out to the criticisms or to the defects, and there's always often a haughty spirit that goes along with it. No matter what you do, if it's right, it's never quite as good. Met some of those people? By the way, they're out there. They think their sword of the Spirit is their ability to hack away on things. And in the end, not much exhortation comes out of that. Come on now, is that right or not? Now here's the deal. Somewhere between the apathetic spirit and the critical spirit is this concept of judgment that is according to the very behavior and beliefs and teachings of God Himself. God is the God who understands judgment to perfection. God is the God who is called the righteous judge, and He understands exactly how to apply His truth and then the consequences that go along with His truth in those who refuse and rebel. Amen. But God is also the God in the midst of His judgment, as He told the Pharisees in Matthew chapter 9. He said, I'm not come to call, the righteous. I'm come to call the sick. I would rather have mercy than sacrifice. It's the same God as He walked to the temple in John chapter 2, turned over the money changers' tables and kicked them all out of the temple. And He said, now this is My Father's house. Do not make My Father's house a house of merchandise. But He's also the same God that there in the temple in Luke 4:18 said, this day has arrived in your life. I am He. I'm come to heal the brokenhearted. I'm come to set the captives free. Luke 4:18 is really the explanation of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Listen, if you don't have life that comes through God, then your life is broken down, and your life is injured, and your life was without purpose. And the Lord said, I'm come, I'm here. I loved you enough to come and bring to you exactly what you need in the issues of life. Oh, God's a perfect judge. Somewhere in our society, we've lost out, whether by apathy or whether by the critical spirit. Clearly in Matthew chapter 7, we're more along the lines of the critical spirit. Judge not, lest ye be judged. By the way, this is the Lord doing the teaching here. Matter of fact, verse 5, He points out our real-time ongoing example of failure. He points out the hypocrites, and clearly in the Scriptures, the hypocrite is really that example of the Pharisees. Oh, the Pharisees, we love them, don't we? We love the Pharisees because they always make us look good. Cue, ha, ha, ha. The Pharisees always make us look good because they always bunk it up, right? They always make the mistake. They never quite understand. They never quite figure out that in all of your desire and passion to be right with God, in the end you missed out on the very nugget of Christianity called love. You missed out. In all of your effort to be righteous, you miss out on the true heart of Christianity, and that is loving God and loving people. There's one truth about it we've all discovered already, and that if you're going to love people, you have to deal with some failures. Of course, not our own. Everybody else's failures. Amen. The old flesh makes a living. The old flesh you know, builds altars and makes itself look good by pointing out everybody else's failures. And the Pharisees were masters at it. The Pharisees were masters at taking the Bible and pointing out everybody else's failures. Listen, you don't love God because you're breaking the law on this issue. Matter of fact, you don't love God as much as I do because your money and your giving, it doesn't match what I give. And your prayer doesn't match my prayer. Listen, in the end, the Lord called those Pharisees whited sepulchres. You look good on the outside, but you're missing life on the inside. You're missing the vibrancy and the vitality of your Christian journey. The Pharisees, once again, become our biblical example of looking at the failures of life. The Lord again he teaches us, judge not. Our flesh, again, just loves to live life by pointing out others' failures. And so God said, now, in the end, it's really an issue of controlling your flesh, because your flesh loves to prey upon other people. Your flesh loves to exalt itself by pointing out and demeaning other people's lives. And so if you can find the defects, you can always make yourself feel a little better. And in the end, the Lord cautions us. But I would say this. The Lord, clearly in the context, is about pulling out motes and beams. Really, the content of Matthew 7 is not about judgment. It's really about being skilled at pulling out motes and beams. It's really the issue of saying, hey, you got a mote in your eye. What are we going to do about that? I remember the first time I stuck a contact in my eye. Back then, I had the hard ones, you know. And I couldn't see, went to the doctor. I would like to get rid of my glasses. I want some contacts. Okay, try this. I stuck that thing in my eye thinking, who in the world in the right mind would come up with this? That's terrible. It's like you stuck a rock in your eye. Who would do that? I remember the first time I found a beam in my eye. You found one in yours yet? You see, the content of Matthew 7 is not, it's not just about the judgment. You know, you can't judge me. I've told you about the bumper sticker I heard or saw years ago. You know, you can't judge me. That's God's job. I remember thinking, I need to pull up next to this guy and say, man, you're a fool. You have no idea what you're talking about. I mean, you would rather me pass some judgment on you than God, the righteous God of heaven. Trust me, if you stand before God having rebelled against every truth of God, trust me, you don't want the wrath of God on your life. You would rather talk to me. I can assure you that. We've all seen that concept again of judgment, but the concept here clearly is more about pulling out motes and beams. Can I suggest to you and make a point here that we don't need motes and beams in our eyes? That's a really simple thing. It took me 3 days to figure that statement out. We don't need motes and beams in our eyes. Matter of fact, you go back in the sixth chapter, the precedent has already been established that the light of the body is the eye. And if the eye is full of light, then the body, the life is full of light, and it's single, and it's focused on the Lord. But if the eye be darkened, if the eye is double vision, if you will, and the darkness that covers the eye, then how great is the darkness that fills the life of a man's life? So the precedent has been established. We need the eyes to be open. We need the eyes to be clear. We need the eyes to see what God wants us to see. Therefore, the man with the mote in his eye is really no better off than the man with the beam in his eye. We're really dealing with a similar problem between the two, because the man with the mote in his eye evidently is not concerned. And the man with the beam in his eye is more concerned about the problems of others than the rafter poking out of his own eye. I wish I had a prop I could stick on my head with a beam poking out of my eye. Amen. It'd make the message that much better. Are you with me this morning? Judge not, lest you be judged. Well, let's consider those consequences of judgment. Point number one, let's consider the consequences of judgment. Can I remind us where people today are deceived about judgment? They would say, you know, you can't judge me. Again, they typically have in mind that I, number one, don't want you telling me right or wrong. I just don't want you to be involved in that process. Number two, I just don't like your dictionary of judgment. I want to kind of rewrite that myself. Don't tell me, you know, about life. Don't tell me that adultery is wrong. Amen. matter of fact, let me say this for us good Christian church-going folk. Listen, it's not so much about the adultery. I mean, that's a big deal. But listen, some things that are creeping into the Christian lives are just good Christian people shacking up together. Let me rephrase that because that's not politically correct. It's good Christian folk believing it's okay to dwell at the same address when they're not married. Listen, can I say that's moats and beams? Well, that's a big issue for us. And by the way, I'm not really intended to be convicting here. That's the Spirit's job. My point is that God said clearly there's problems with motes and beams, and one guy evidently is not concerned about the speck of sawdust in his eye, and it's causing him just as much trouble as the guy with the beam poking out of his eye. But one is apathetic and the other is critical. So it's just not necessary for me to worry about the mote in my eye. You know, it doesn't really matter if we are obedient to everything that God teaches. Let's just handle, you know, if we do 75% of it, we're better than most people. Amen. Listen, that's a moat that's dangerous and in the end blocks the eyes of good believers. But the other one is that critical spirit. The consequences then clearly are those who would say, well, you can't judge me. And in the end, the condemnation for sin. Listen to what the Bible says in Romans chapter 8. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, listen to this now, condemned sin in the flesh. Now listen, we're going to celebrate Christmas here in a few days. Listen, what was Christmas about? It's about the birth of Christ, but let's make no mistake. The Lord came in the flesh that he might die on the cross. It's impossible to celebrate Christmas without recognizing Easter in the process. There's no way to say we can celebrate the life of Christ without celebrating the death of Christ at the same time. But here's the beauty of it. God came in the flesh that he might condemn sin in the flesh. Well, you can't judge me. Trust me, brother. Trust me. I don't have enough power, but let's make no mistake. The birth of Christ and the death of Christ was all about judgment. It was all about judgment. That's Romans chapter 8. Of course, the other verse comes, well, there's many others. John chapter 3, of course, verse 16 we all know well. Verse 17 and 18 go right along with it, and it says, therefore God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Now capture that. Romans 8 said Christ came to condemn sin in the flesh. And he says, now I didn't send him to condemn the world or condemn people. I sent him to condemn flesh. But here's the light bulb going on. Sin and people are one thing. Is that right? Now here's the beauty of the birth of Christ and ultimately the death of Christ. Verse 18 goes on and says for us, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Somebody tells you down the road here, and so, well, you can't judge me. You tell them this answer. It's already been done. It's already over. We're not talking future here. We're talking past. Is that right? Your sin has already condemned you, and God said for the wage or the payment of that sin is death, and it's death for eternity. Someone again says to you, you can't judge me. You just tell them, well, good thing I don't have to, because it's already been secured and done. Now you got a choice. The beauty is you got a choice. You can either suffer the consequences of your condemned sin and life, or you can simply believe on the name of Jesus Christ. And you can be removed, you can be redeemed, you can escape the consequences of sin. But let's make no mistake, the idea of judging the world or judging sin has already been done. It's the arrival of Christ and the death of Christ to say indeed that sin must be judged. By the way, let me reiterate one point here and support it with one thought. The wrath of God that's poured out upon sin, there's only one thing that will satisfy the wrath of God, and that is the pure blood of Jesus Christ. God is known as, biblically, God is propitiated, and it means that God is satisfied with the one and only blood of Jesus Christ. Make no mistake, though God says for us not to judge, judgment has been done. Judgment will certainly be carried out. What I would also say again, as we've already mentioned, is the consequences of judgment is not just the condemnation for sin, but it's also the condemnation of hypocrisy. These Pharisees didn't seem to understand. They'd missed out on that most important point, and that again is the idea of love. It must be noted that the one with the mote and the one with the beams in their eyes are both in the wrong. Yet helping each other is the true motive of judgment. Why do you judge one another? Why did God judge sin? Because unless God judges sin, there's no salvation. Unless sin is dealt with, there is no heaven or eternity or salvation. Amen. And in the end, God said, now let's remind ourselves, this one with the mote in his eye and this one with the beam, the reason why you point those things out is because it's motivated by love. I want to help you. We ought to have a motivation to help and point out and or judge, in a sense, by telling one another, hey, that there's problems in life and we can help each other. We can exhort each other. We can encourage each other. We can edify one another. And in the end, the Bible condemns the hypocrisy in this context of the Pharisees and in our day, those that are of a critical spirit, to point out problems without a motivation to help one another. Oh, we can camouflage it. We can camouflage, and Miss Sarah, I'm going to pick on you because you're on the front row. Thanks for being here. We can camouflage and say, your clothing is terrible. It's not appropriate for God. Go change your clothes. Rather than saying, you know why we dress appropriately, or you know why we have a heart to do that? Because God is worth it. It's not just your clothes. It's we have a heart to give God our very, very best. And we love the Lord. Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and body. The strength of life is found in living for God in a way that honors God because we love him. And whatever criticisms may or may not come, it must be motivated by a purpose of love. Is that right or not? Boy, the concept is so easy and yet profound. Our society is just dying on the hill of not discerning proper judgment. Oh, the condemnation for hypocrisy, having a heart for love. Some would say, again, you can't judge me, but I would simply say this, God clearly makes the point that judgment is really not about a denial of love, but rather a demonstration of it. I thought about Hebrews chapter 12 there, where it says, whom the Lord loves, he chastens. I remember my dad teaching me as a boy, I'm going to spank you because I love you. I remember thinking in my little mind, that is the most ridiculous idea. Who comes up with that stuff? You don't love me. You're trying to kill me. But can I tell you, and I learned this as a little boy. By the way, our society absolutely says, do not follow biblical chastening principles. But I can tell you right now, I'm a testimony. There's not one time after I was disciplined, judged. There's not one time after I was disciplined that I wondered if my parents loved me. Not one time. Maybe before, as we were negotiating the situation. Wasn't a whole lot of negotiation. Not one time after I was done that I ever wondered if my dad loved me. Not one time. Listen, judgment is not a denial of love. It's actually a demonstration of love. You say, well, if you love me, you won't pass those things upon me. No, no, no. God said, because I do love you, I need to tell you the truth. Because I do love you enough to say that ain't the way it's supposed to be done. That's not going to get you to heaven. Then this is not the way to live the Christian life. And in the end, as we judge not, lest we be judged, we make sure that our heart is in tune, but we're motivated by a cause of betterment and encouragement and love for the Lord. Remember the story in John chapter 8? I was in Sunday school this morning, and Brother Tom Belace brought a lesson for this morning. Boy, it really brought it out in my message this morning. And he was talking about the woman caught in adultery. Remember John chapter 8? Remember the story? The Pharisees drug her before the law. Ah, she's caught in adultery, red-handed. Man, matter of fact, according to the law, we pass judgment by killing her. And the Lord, of course, you know there. Not the Lord denied judgment in her life, but he stooped down on the ground and wrote on the ground. Well, one of these days we'll figure out exactly what he wrote. And he looks up and says, "You that are have no sin, you cast the first stone." And he stooped down a second time to write on the ground and looked up, and everybody's gone. Everybody's gone. You know what the Lord said to her? Where are those that condemn you? Now, please make mistake. Don't make any mistakes here now. God didn't overlook her adultery. Because in just four words or five words, the Lord there, about verse 10 or 11, actually about verse 8, he said, "Go and sin no more." I imagine the Lord, it's emphatic by our Savior. I can imagine the Lord said, now, honey, let's don't do that again. You know, that's not the right way to do it. I can imagine, like the Lord, looking at Peter as Peter stood around the fire the night of his betrayal, warming himself around the fire. The Bible says the eyes of the Lord looked upon him, and all it took was the eyes of our Savior. Pierced Peter right through the heart. Peter went out crying and weeping because of the conviction of God for his denial. I imagine the words of our Savior, "Go and sin no more," were just as penetrative in her life as it was Peter. Make no mistake, God judges. But God told the woman, "I'm going to tell you right now, I can judge your sin, but I want you to know first and foremost, I love you. Go and sin no more." Listen, parents, don't let anybody tell you that disciplining your child according to biblical measures is not a demonstration of your love, because God says it is. It's the balance of finding judgment and consequence coupled with the motivation of love and fear for God. And in the year, God honors that. Amen. Well, the consequences for sin are terrible upon life. Now, God will condemn sin, but he also condemns hypocrisy. Galatians 6 and 1, "Brethren, when a brother is overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one, considering thyself in the spirit of meekness, lest thou also be tempted." Boy, we take a brother who's failed. The word fault is the idea of trespass. It's the idea of committing a sin. And when he's overtaken in his fault, God said, now you which are spiritual, you go to him and you love on him. And the Greek language, the word restore, literally means to set a broken bone. There's been a dangerous injury happened because of sin. But you which are spiritual, go and tell him. He knows that it's wrong. God has convicted him, and you encourage what God has taught him. But in the process, you love on him, and you restore him. Amen. Help him, by the way, in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. How many people who have a critical spirit have pointed out the faults of others, and yet clearly in Matthew 7, the beam of poking out of their own eye, they don't even recognize their own faults. It's the haughty, prideful disposition to say, you're not right with God. Nevertheless, just forget the fact that I'm not right with God. But in the end, you're much worse a problem than my beam poking out of the eye. And in the end, God condemns. It condemns sin. He condemns hypocrisy. Finally and quickly is the idea of the difficulty with judgment. The word judge is used a couple of times in Scripture. Here, the context is the idea of condemnation. Judge not, lest you be judged. Matter of fact, the same judgment of which you give, it will be measured unto you again. You know, everybody's up for that, I'm sure. But then he goes on and says, now, pulling out this mote and this beam, it really is an issue of discernment. The problem with judgment is we must make sure that we have a proper eyesight, pulling out the beam and pulling out the mote. And in the end, the problem is simply that of having this critical spirit and not seeing things the way the Lord would have us to see them, motes and beams. Let's make no mistake again, the mote is a sinful thing, just as the beam. But as one with a critical spirit would point out the problems of others, they oftentimes will neglect as they gossip about the problems of others. Although I have a critical spirit, a of the things of others, or give a false report about the things of others, or failing to forgive the things of others, or failing to admonish or exhort them in their Christian walk. We can point out the problems, but because we're not seeing properly, we fail, and we often will gossip about the problems of others. God said that's a beam poking out of your own eye rather than the mote that you've discovered in the eye of someone else. Well, the concept is, again, the difficulty being with judgments that we are not able to see. The issue at hand is a discernment issue. Condemnation belongs to God, but discernment is the responsibility of every believer. Every believer. Can I suggest to you where our country and our society has a problem with understanding right and wrong? It's because they do not understand spiritually the things of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. But do not let their disillusionment affect you. Because they don't understand right and wrong, don't let it affect you. Because God wants you to see clearly. God wants you to understand clearly the things of life. Don't judge based on prejudiced information. Don't judge the inner motive of another, for God is only the one who sees the hearts of men. Don't judge using yourself as the standard of righteousness, for that belongs to God. The beams of gossip and false report and failing to admonish or forgive is based on often prejudice or looking for others' motives in the issue, or using ourselves as a standard rather than God. And in the end, God condemns the beam as well as the mote. Another difficulty with judgment, as I just mentioned, is the idea of the disillusionment about truth. Some people believe that this passage overrules all other passages. You can't judge me, therefore, that there's nothing, there really is no consequences. Again, by the way, our society is building itself on this premise, and that's why I think it's one of the most damaging and eroding factors, is because we're evidently at the point where we can't tell anybody about right or wrong. We can't even tell our own children about what's right or wrong. We certainly can't pass any kind of consequence on that goes along with the punishment or with the judgment. And our society is building itself off of redefining what is right and or wrong. And in the end, the problem is a disillusionment about truth. And this passage believing that it overrules all other passages about judgment. Now, listen to a few verses here. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, in the Corinthian church, they were dealing with an open issue of adultery. They were dealing with an issue in the church that everybody knew, that brother so-and-so and sister so-and-so were having an illicit affair. Matter of fact, the church was prideful because they thought they could handle it and just kind of let it go on and still be spiritual. And Paul writes the letter. And rather than condemning the individual, he chastens the church for their lack of dealing with it. And in verse number 5, how about this for judgment? Verse number 5, 1 Corinthians 5, Paul said, take the man who's caught in adultery, deliver him unto Satan for the destruction of his flesh. Turn him over to Satan that Satan might kill him, that the spirit might be saved. Can you imagine reading that letter in church? Brother so-and-so, would you please stand up? We have a verdict from the great apostle Paul, and we all are in agreement. We're turning you over to Satan for you to die. God bless you. Listen, folks, that's real deal stuff, 1 Corinthians 5. That's the Corinthian church. Listen, make no mistake, where they would say, you can't judge me. Again, the issue of disillusionment about truth is, and listen, it matters to God. It matters to God. Other portions of Scripture, by the way, we're not turning anybody over to Satan nowadays. But make no mistake, the consequences and the disillusion about truth. Matthew 18, the church discipline passage. If a brother trespass against thee, then go and tell him his fault. And if he'll hear you, then you've gained a brother. But if he won't listen to you, then take with you two or three witnesses, that in the mouths of two or three, every word may be established. And if he'll hear them, thou hast gained a brother. But if he will not, tell it to the church. And if he will not hear the church, listen to this, verse 18, Matthew 18, let him be unto you as a heathen and a publican. Whoopee. Well, you can't judge me. Please understand. Please understand. Sin, open sin in the midst of the church, God said, it must be judged. By the way, we just live for those days, don't we? We just hope those services come rolling around. Because you won't submit to God, then we have to deal with you according to God's scripture. And guess what? You are like a heathen and a publican unto us. Not just the pastor, every member. You mean my best friend? Absolutely. You mean my father or my mother? Yes, ma'am. My son or my daughter? Absolutely. You mean the preacher's kids? You betcha. By the way, that's real deal stuff. Well, the disillusionment about truth is we can't see clearly. God said, make no mistake. There's one of the problems is disillusionment. Truth is truth. You can't judge me. God said, no, we have to take care of things. There's all kinds of scriptures. Discipline within the church, discipline with open sin. But I love 1 Corinthians 11:31, and this one I'll be done. 1 Corinthians 11:31, the Lord's Supper passage, as the Apostle Paul is teaching the Corinthian believers. He goes through all the details of the Lord's Supper. Verse 31, if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. If we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. Listen, it's really simply this. If you got a mote in your eye, don't wait for somebody else. If you got a beam in your eye, don't wait for somebody else. If we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. How do you feel about your mote? Have you learned to live with it? You know, are you okay with not complete obedience in your heart when you know God's given clear instruction of how things are supposed to be? Are you okay with that? I can tell you right now, if you are, then that's a mote in your eye. But what about you? That critical spirit. You come into church on Sunday, you can barely find a seat because you can't sit still enough because of all the problems in the church. Listen to me. God said, that's a beam in your eye. You okay with that? By the way, if you got a beam in your eye, be careful coming to the door. You're liable to hurt somebody. And the truth is simply this, if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. We should not. In other words, God puts it upon you to come to God and confess our sin. 1 John chapter 1, verse number 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. You know what verse 8 says? If a man say he has no sin, he deceives himself. He deceives himself. It's amazing how the man with the beam in his eye thinks everything is in order. He's deceived. If we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. So let me finish with this simple question. Do you have love? Is love your motivator? Because love will not stand by and allow the mote to turn to an infection that causes the eyesight to go away, that in the end causes your life to spiral out of control. Love won't allow it. Your love for God will drive you to the throne of God and confess your sin. Your love for God will cause you to look at your life and inspect its elements to such a degree that you will not be tolerant of the things that you know are not right. But do you have love enough to take the beam out of your own eye in order to go help your brother? How many people have motes in their eyes waiting for the one that has the beam in his eye to rid himself of that to come to their rescue? Amen. it's interesting to me that God didn't reverse it. It wasn't the beam having the problem and the mote guy being critical. It's the guy with the mote in his eye, the little speck of thing that doesn't seem to understand. And God says to the guy with the beam, get that out of your eye so you can go help the individual. It seems to me the ones with the most knowledge are the ones who have the problems with the beams. It appears that the ones who are supposedly the most mature are the ones often who have the beams in their eyes. God said, get it out so you can go help the one who doesn't understand the damaging effect of the little things that he clearly gives away. In the end, do we love the Lord? Judge not, lest you be judged. But in the end, let's deal with it ourselves. May the Lord give us strength and encouragement and love and discernment to know to come to the Lord. I would finish with this. Everybody in life is depending on us to do so. Your children, your wife, your husband, your parents, your coworkers, your friendships, your church brothers and sisters, your acquaintances, the lost man in the world who has yet to meet you is depending on you to see things clearly, that you might be the representative of the Lord with the gospel of Christ. Amen? Amen. So what's it take for us to deal with the issues of life? Father, we thank you, Lord, this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Father, it's condemning, it's challenging, it's convicting in our heart. Father, it points out the problems that you see so clearly. And Father, I pray that we would be able to see clearly the things of life. Father, rather than help having us cower at the ideas of conviction. Father, help us to stand strong and have faith in you, believing and running to you, Lord, for forgiveness. Father, help us on our journey. Help us, Lord, as we embrace this wonderful teaching of the Lord. Father, we love you. We thank you, Lord, again for the good morning. We pray that you'll be with the time of invitation. Father, do a work in our heart. We trust these things now in your care, and we ask them in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together, would you please?